To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. We have a quorum this evening, so thank you, commissioners. Announcements.
I have no announcements this evening.
Moving right along to next item on the agenda, which is review and approval of the minutes of June 18th, 2018. If there are no questions or comments on the minutes, I'll take a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All those, any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Moving next on to the next item on the agenda, unfinished business, rezoning R16-0009. I would note that Ms. Carter has recused herself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So as you know, tonight you are to be taking a vote on the Palmers Creek rezoning. At the last meeting, there were a lot of questions about the modified intersection improvements in lieu of a traffic signal. And so we do have Kyle Bates. He's the assistant residency engineer for VDOT with us, and he has a video to show you, and he'll be available to answer any questions that you have if you desire.
All right, thank you all for having me. Again, my name's Kyle Bates. I'm the assistant residency engineer here in the Fredericksburg residency. So Spotsylvania being part of the Fredericksburg residency. So here I am. I kind of have a few things to talk about. One of which is gonna be a video kind of just giving you a brief description of what this modified Green T intersection is. So it's not gonna be an exact replica per se of the intersection that we're talking about at Palmers Creek, but that being said, it's going to give you a general idea of how these intersections work, which I believe, in speaking with Wanda, I think that was one of the big questions you all had previously. So I will talk a little bit. So Route 1 was designated back in, I think, 2009 as a corridor of statewide significance. So we try and keep traffic moving on Route 1. That's definitely something we're always looking into. When we have new developments come in or developers that are coming in to upgrade an intersection, we always make them look into alternatives prior to just putting in a signal. We try and put in a few amount of signals, as least as we can, to a standpoint of we want to keep people moving at all times, especially on these corridors of statewide significance. So just to give you a little bit of information about how that happens from a VDOT perspective, we make the developers look into a roundabout. If it's not a roundabout, the next step, if this is a arterial preservation network, which Route 1 is, in this area is, the next step is we look into different kinds of alternative intersections, non-signalized alternative intersections. If those meet warrants, then we look at the signalized alternative intersections. And then the last case scenario would be a fully signalized intersection. So that being said, the Palmers Creek intersection that we're speaking about tonight met the warrants and we were able to go forward with a non-signalized alternative intersection. So in this case, we're talking about the modified Green T intersection. So what I'll do, I've given you all some handouts I gave to Wanda. I don't know if she's passed those out yet, but if you have those, that kind of gives you a brief rundown of what these intersections are and when they're good to utilize, they're successful. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and just play a video real quick, and I can answer some questions afterwards. If I don't have the information for you tonight, if we're talking about some specifics, I'd be happy to look into it, and I can always get back with you. So with that, I'll go ahead and play the video. I think we have some sound here.
The Virginia Department of Transportation, VDOT, in its commitment to improving safety and mobility for all road users in Virginia, presents Innovative Intersections and Interchanges. The Continuous Green T, or CGT, is one type of innovative intersection. A CGT is a three-legged intersection where one direction of travel on the major street can pass straight through the intersection without stopping. CGTs are designed to accommodate all roadway users, including larger vehicles such as school buses, emergency vehicles, and trucks, as well as pedestrians and cyclists. Let's take a closer look at how a CGT works for motorists. On the major street, one direction of travel continues straight without stopping at the traffic signal. Motorists who wish to turn left from this direction must first stop at the traffic signal before completing their movement. In the opposite direction, motorists turn right and continue straight, just like at a conventional T intersection. From the side street, motorists turn right like at a conventional intersection. To turn left from the side street, motorists use the channelized lane to merge onto the major street after passing through the traffic signal. Pedestrians use marked crosswalks to safely cross the side street. For pedestrian safety, crosswalks are not provided across the major street at a CGT. To cross the major street, pedestrians may use nearby crosswalks at adjacent intersections or mid-block crossings. Cyclists have the choice to either navigate the intersections using crosswalks and pedestrian paths, or, if they're more comfortable, cyclists can follow the same paths as vehicles. There are several benefits of a CGT design, such as improved safety. Channelization of left-turn vehicles from the side street at a CGT reduces the potential for angle crashes. Increased efficiency. Because one direction of travel on the major street is free flow from a CGT, more time can be provided to the other movements, reducing the delay for everyone. Free flow in one direction. One direction of travel on the major street never stops at a CGT, which helps to coordinate adjacent traffic signals and reduces travel times in the corridor. To improve safety and efficiency on Virginia roads, VDOT works with local jurisdictions to find the right intersection type for a location and tailors the design to its specific needs. To learn more about CGTs and other innovative intersection designs, visit VDOT's website at www.virginiadot.org/innovative-intersections.
All right, so hope you all enjoyed that. That was a little bit more of an intense intersection than the one we're going to be getting at Palmer's Creek. They had some pedestrian accommodations and signalized stuff like that. But in the Palmer's Creek intersection that the developer's looking to put in, they're going to have it's not going to be signalized, so you're going to have to yield just like you would anywhere else, but you have a channel. If you're turning left out of Palmer's Creek, you have that median that you have to utilize and then merge into Route 1. It keeps everybody moving on the mainline traffic. So that being said, I hope that answered some questions for you all. I can take some questions.
I have a question if you don't mind. Are there lights at this intersection?
At the intersection at Palmer's Creek, no, sir.
There'll be no lights.
No,
well,
sir.
How does this guy coming, going north, he's going to turn left? Why does the traffic on the other side just stop for him? If there are no lights, why does the southbound traffic stop for the northbound turns?
Right. So the southbound traffic on Route 1 won't stop for turns. That's the idea of this intersection. So when you have the people coming out of
Palmer's Creek and wants to turn left.
Correct.
He doesn't have a stoplight to prevent him from pulling out in front of somebody.
Nope, it would be a stop sign,
right?
And that person
He'll have a sign.
Correct. And that person would then have to navigate across the two lanes of traffic like they normally would now. But the difference being that you get to pull into that area where you have a merge lane that you can then merge into the northbound side.
Okay, I see how that works, but I still don't like the idea the guy has to stop on four-lane highway from this place and he doesn't have a light for safety. Traffic is moving north and south without stopping for anybody.
Right. Well, just given you only have to navigate the two lanes at a time, so you wouldn't have to navigate all four lanes all at once. You would just be going across. You'd have to look, if you're coming out of that intersection, you'd have to look at the southbound traffic, navigate across that, and then it's an easy merge onto northbound Route 1.
And where are these things being built besides here?
There's some other ones in the state. We're not the first, but just another alternative. And I can look into that and send
you guys
some
other
locations.
That's okay. I'm just a curious question. Thank you.
So you're saying this type of intersection is safer than one that is controlled by a signal device?
Yes, I would say so.
Wait, I mean, do you have any statistics or data?
Yeah, I can look into that.
And how many of these are in Virginia?
I can find out for you. I can give you some, like he was saying, I can give you some locations as far as where we might have some in the state of Virginia. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so if you install one of these intersections, if it became a traffic problem, like, you know, if there were an increase in traffic accidents, you know, things like that, VDOT looks at that and then they would adjust and make it a stoplight if necessary.
Absolutely.
Something like that. I don't know the...
Just in generally speaking, VDOT's always going to be looking. We get intersections on a yearly basis where we look at crash data throughout the entire region. And we prioritize our funds based on where the safety need is, just in a general manner of speaking. But absolutely, if there were issues, VDOT would be on it.
That's what I thought. Because sure. I was like, you know, I think I see that a lot of us that are from here, we're not used to this kind of pattern.
Yeah.
But it may take us a little while. There's going to be a learning curve. And then if we can't catch up, we can't figure it out, then VDOT would be there to catch us.
Very much right? So. And from our standpoint, we want to get ahead of this as much as we possibly can. So there will be multiple press releases that go out. We're not just going to throw it out there one day and say, oh, everybody figure it out. We're going to be very much ahead of this. We're going to – there you go. The video is very helpful. So we can put press releases out. We'll have this out. This is on our website. There's a lot of information out there. This brochures that you all have, I mean, that's something that's going to be posted out to the public from a press release locally. I mean, we will absolutely get out ahead of this.
So the purpose of this alignment is to meet the goal of keeping traffic moving on Route 1.
Correct.
To improve efficiency.
Correct.
Otherwise, with a signal, we'll continue to have the issue of poor intersections and level of service and all those types
Absolutely.
Of things.
Absolutely. You run into what you've got in some other areas, not necessarily just in this county, but on Route 1 in general, maybe a little further up north, where you're stopping every, seems
right.
like 500 feet.
So one question on the plan, though. On the left turn lane coming out of Palmas Creek, I recall in the video you had a raised island to delineate the main through lanes with that left that would merge into the left north lane.
Correct.
I think on this plan, it's not a raised island. Is that a striped?
I believe in the plans that are actually
I'm trying
out
to tell
there.
From the plans here what we have for an island there to delineate that movement.
Yes, I believe it's a raised concrete median. And one of the concerns was how do people know to get into that median? I mean, that was my first question, too, was,
right.
There could be the obstacle of you turning left, and if you don't know to go into that concrete median, if you don't make it into that slot right there, you could potentially run into oncoming traffic. Obviously, not something we want to put people into. So we talked about, similar to what the video had, is some hash marks to guide motorists into that opening into that concrete median. You'll have a concrete median on both sides of you once you're in that channelized median. And when you are in that channelized median, you have X amount of feet, and then you'll merge into the northbound Route 1.
Do you have any intersections or turning movements like this without a concrete median? Are you aware of any?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Would it be... I just want to confirm that there is a concrete raised median there because it was important to delineate that movement. And if not, if it's a striped movement, then would it be possible to have the plastic delineators to kind of separate that? For safety reasons.
If there were not a concrete median?
Yeah, I just want to be sure I understand what that is.
Absolutely. The concrete median, and we can look into some other options just from a maintenance standpoint as far as do we need to paint the median, things like that.
But and this would be determined through the site plan process?
That's correct.
One final question. I recall, maybe one you can help me, that the applicant is providing a proffer for a signal. Did I misunderstand that? No?
No, sir. There's no proffer for a signal. I believe that during the applicant's presentation, they indicated that the property owner had set aside funds for a signal in the future, but that's not a proffer
So where are the funds? Are they in escrow, or do we know that?
I don't know that.
Okay. Can you?
The applicant is here. We can't ask them.
I will ask the applicant where these funds would lie.
Mr. Newhouse, I do, just to answer your question about the concrete median, and if we can have the floor monitor, please. But all of this is painted markings to help guide them through. This is, of course, a concrete island here. And then this strip right here, that is the concrete, kind of a skinny median that's creating that channel. Now, this is still painted, so it's not concrete.
But in the video, that was concrete.
It was concrete.
I think in the video they had even just a grass median.
Right. Either way, it's a raised median.
What you said is exactly on point. Delineators to keep people from just turning right into.
And that would be determined through the site plan process. What to make this a safe turning movement. Okay. I would like to ask the applicant for the dedication of these funds where that would go, if it's in an escrow or.
Chairman, members of the commission, Sherman Patrick here representing Don Hart and J.P. Moore, Highland with Bonaventure. The answer to that is that we've placed the money, or will place the money, in escrow. That's our intention. It's through a contractual agreement with another property owner. So it will be set aside. It's my understanding that we're not in a position where we can proffer it.
I would agree. Yep. Bad terminology, my end. Escrow seems appropriate in the county.
That's our intention. Yes,
okay,
sir.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yeah.
Kimberly, how many vehicles a day will be coming out of Palmas Creek onto Route 1? Do we know?
At build-out, Palmers Creek is expected to generate 2,271 vehicles per day, and that includes the commercial component as well. And the commercial component, obviously, is the majority
of those
trips.
That's the only way for them to come out at that intersection, correct?
So there's two points of access. I want to see an overall here. This is the one with the continuous green tea intersection. And you'll recall there's no left turns in at that location. The left turns in will be at this southern entrance. So it'll be a right out and lefts in.
And we will have, in this development, they'll have school-aged children living there?
Yes, sir.
So how's the school, which entrance are the school buses going to be using to come in and out of there? Do we know?
Well, depending on what location, you know, what direction they're coming from, if they're coming south, they'll be able to take the right in and up this access road. If they're coming from the north, then they will have to enter and take a left at the southern entrance.
Right. So if they want to come out, then it's a possibility the school buses are going to have to battle that traffic to make that turn onto Route 1 at that intersection.
Sure. It depends on their route, but absolutely.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Any questions or comments for the applicant? Very well. The public hearing was closed, so we won't be taking any other presentations or anything like that. So at this point, without any further questions or comments, I'm going to make a motion that we approve this application, R16-0009. As it's provided in the staff write-up. Can I have a second on that?
Yes.
Very good. We have a second. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
We have one no. Motion passes. Thank you. Moving on to the next item on the agenda, special use permit 18-0006.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a request for special use permit approval to allow public utility light on rural zoned property. The approval of the special use will allow a pipeline inspection insertion facility on a residential lot located at 15213 Spotswood Furnace Road, as you see on this vicinity map here. And you'll recall you recommended approval of one on the east side of the reservoir not too long ago. It's shown, you can see the proximity there. Staff is recommending approval with conditions. Here is a zoning map. You can see the surrounding area is all rural zoning with predominantly all large lots averaging 5 acres in size. Here's an aerial shot. The property is surrounded on all three sides with existing residential properties, all approximately 5 acres in size. The closest residence is here and is approximately 435 feet away. The subject property itself is 5.16 acres, and there is an exclusive easement with Columbia Gas of Virginia on a portion of the property, which includes this yellow shaded area that totals 0.32 acres. And this is to accommodate the pig insertion facility. Here is an image of what one of these would look like. A pig insertion facility, also called a pig launcher, it's essentially a empty above ground pipes that serve as an access port. The pipeline inspection gauge, the pig, is inserted into the pipeline port and travels through the gas mains in order to clean, inspect, provide data for maintenance and purposes for Columbia Gas. Here's the GDP. I've zoomed in on the facility itself, which also shows the landscaping. Access to the pig site will be with a VDOT approved paved entrance on Spotswood Furnace Road. It'll be 10 foot in width gravel that will actually run from Spotswood Furnace Road along the existing gas line easement to the facility. The facility is set back from the right of way approximately 625 feet and be completely secured with a 6 foot chain link fence, which is screened with the forest green slats within the chain link. The access gate will include security locking system to be accessed by Columbia Gas employees only. The fenced area is approximately 7,500 square feet. It's gravel. The piping and the access ports are approximately 4 feet above ground. However, with the fencing and with the landscaping that's being provided, these are the Nellie Stephen holly trees. They're an evergreen species. These above ground pipes will be completely screened from view. Once operational, the pig operation is performed once a year, and the facility will be inspected once every couple of months, so the traffic generated from this use is minimal. This is a photo taken on site. This is standing at the edge of the proposed facility facing east towards Spotswood Furnace Road. And you can see my vehicle, that's where I actually pulled in. Again, there's such significant existing vegetation on this lot and on the surrounding lots. This is the gas line easement, so this is the 40 feet width of clearing that's existing. But again, it's 625 feet back, and it will be tucked into this vegetation here on the side with the fencing, with the landscaping. This image is standing at the edge of the property of the closest house. So the closest house was 435 feet away. I'm standing at the edge of their property line, which is about 100 feet from their house. And this is looking at the facility where the arrow is pointing. And this is about 350 feet away. Again, with the existing vegetation, the fencing, the visual impacts are really minimal. Findings in favor include that the proposal is consistent and compatible with the development district and the land use designation as dictated in the comprehensive plan. The visual impacts have been mitigated with the proposed landscaping and the fencing, and of course the existing vegetation and the significant setback from the right-of-way. And the proposal provides a necessary piece of public infrastructure which will enhance the efficiency and safety to serve the county population. The proposed use satisfies the 8 standards of review for special use permits, and based on the findings in favor, staff is recommending approval with the following conditions: that the site be developed in conformance with the generalized development plan, the facility be completely fenced, and all fencing will be at least 6 feet in height and include the screening slats, that the landscaping will be provided around the facility as shown on the GDP, and that the facility shall not be lit. And that concludes my presentation. The applicant's representative is here. He doesn't have a presentation. He does agree with staff's recommended conditions, but he's happy to answer any questions that you may have.
And safety features include a locked fence?
It will be a locked gate, only accessible by Columbia Gas.
Would fire rescue ever have a need to get to this facility? Would they have access?
With any of those facilities, they're given the code, or and that would all be fleshed out during the site plan process.
Site plan, okay. Any questions or comments for the applicant or Kim at this point? At this point, I'll open up the public hearing for comment. As you come to the podium, you'll have 3 minutes. If you represent an organization, please state so, and you will have 5 minutes. When the light turns, you'll see a green light. When it turns yellow, you'll have 1 minute left. And when it's red, I would ask you to wrap up your comments. And when you come up to the podium, if you'd state your name and your voting district, and if you don't know that, your address is fine.
No one signed up for tonight.
Well, no one signed up. I'll open it up for a comment from anybody if they wish. Okay, hearing none, I'll close the public hearing. This is straightforward to me. It's in my district. I will make a motion to approve with conditions as outlined in the package. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. So next up is a discussion item on CA18-0005, authorization to advertise subdivision ordinance amendments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. This is a very small amendment to the subdivision ordinance. The county is currently going through a review with the Chesapeake Bay Act. And because the county is under the Chesapeake Bay Act, there are a number of requirements that we need to have in our ordinances. And they've identified some areas that they've asked us to amend so that we would be consistent with the requirements. So there are 3 areas within the plat section of the subdivision ordinance. 2 of them are notes that they are requesting are placed on the plats. And those relate to notify the property owner that they have a resource protection area on their property and that they cannot disturb that resource protection area. So it's really a safeguard to whoever's purchasing a property. When they get their plat, they will see that note. The other one is that on-site sewage systems require pump out every 5 years. So that's another notification to any property owner that they will need to maintain their system through the required pump out every 5 years. And
for a subsurface?
For a septic system.
Okay, is that, why is that? Why is there a requirement for every 5 years? Is that just good
that's
maintenance?
That's Chesapeake Bay. Chesapeake Bay Act, 5 years maintenance, pump out, yes.
That only pertains to lots within the, are we totally within the Chesapeake Bay?
Yes, the entire county is under the Chesapeake Bay Act. And these are items that are actually in our Chesapeake Bay Ordinance, which is Chapter 6A of the county code. But they like to see these notes right on the plats to give notice to anybody that is purchasing a lot that they're aware of these rather than them being.
Well, I certainly support that.
Yeah, and then the third item is actually on the plats themselves, that when we review them, that they need to depict the primary and the 100% reserve area, which is right. part of our standard operating procedures right now, but they'd like to see it actually listed as a requirement in the ordinance that it be shown.
Right. So any, and just to ask a question around that, so any subsurface disposal permit application will identify primary and
a 100%
reserve.
Yes.
And that's regardless of the type of drain field it is?
Correct, okay. Yes.
Ms. Carter, did you have
anything? Yes, I did, please. Wanda, I heard this, that if a person, if it's just one person living in a household, that the 5 years is extended out further. Is that correct?
I'm not aware of that. I'd have to check with our environmental folks to see, because we don't actually handle that five-year pump-out portion of it in the county, but I can check with the people that do.
Would you please?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, ma'am. Anything else, Wanda?
No, that's it. So what I'm asking is for the Planning Commission to authorize the public hearing, and because this is a code amendment, we have that statement under the recommendation on your cover sheet that I'd request that whoever makes the motion read. It says, based on public necessity. That's how it
Help
starts.
Help me out. Where are based? Okay.
Under the recommendation on the executive summary.
I have it now.
Okay.
Does anybody care to read this? I'm happy to.
Please, you do it.
All right, I'll make a motion based on public necessity, convenience, the general welfare, good subdivision practices, and compliance with the Virginia Code. I move that the Planning Commission initiate changes to the Spotsylvania County ordinances found in Chapter 20, amending and adding provisions related to subdivision approval procedures to ensure compliance with the Chesapeake Bay Act.
Second.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. Okay, I guess we're on to the work session. I'm not too sure about this. All three of you up here.
Well, this is the work session that we were going to have last time, but it was the only item on the agenda, so the decision was let's move it on to this one. So it's a little bit more than what we had originally planned for last time, but I think it'll go fairly quickly and provide some good information for the Planning Commission. And we're just seeking feedback at this point on a few items before we move forward and start working on them to be sure that we're heading in the right direction. So tonight we're going to talk about the future land use chapter of the plan, and we included a copy of that in the packets, and the primary development boundary. So we're going to start out with Patrick going over an overview of the future land use map and the designations within that chapter. And then he's going to talk about some work he's been doing to provide future development build-out analysis of the primary development boundary as part of the Water and Sewer Master Plan update that's undergoing update right now. And so after that, I'm going to talk a little bit more about the primary development boundary itself and some areas that are difficult to serve and some requests we've received from citizens to expand the primary development boundary. And then Jacob's going to conclude with some discussion about the specific designations within the future land use element, such as employment center and the mixed use, and some areas where we'd like some feedback on potentially expanding them a little bit, providing a little more guidance in there. In some ways, they're very general. And we think that perhaps focusing in on some more specificity might be beneficial as the county moves forward, looking at development, rezonings, and being able to target areas where specific types of development are appropriate or inappropriate. So with that, I'll turn it over to Patrick.
Good evening. Thanks for your time. I do have a few slides to present to you related to this topic. As part of the amendment cycle of the comprehensive plan, one of the things we're, of course, looking at is the future land use map. The map and also the text itself. The future land use map is, of course, part of the comp plan. It's valuable to us because in every rezoning or special use case, staff examines the comp plan, examines the future land use element of the comp plan, and ultimately uses the information that's in that element to make a recommendation for or against, or different findings of fact for or against that particular public hearing case. There's a variety of future land use designations in the county. I'm gonna briefly walk you through them. They're loosely ranked from most dense to least dense, starting with the mixed use area. The mixed use future land use designation is without a doubt one of the most dense future land use designations available in the county. That designation, per the comp plan, is intended to provide retail, employment, entertainment. It's a traditional live, work, play kind of concept where interconnected streets and sidewalks create smaller setbacks all kind of come together to create a more urban feel and a mix of uses. The high density residential is the second most dense. This is a future land use designation that's largely mapped over our existing apartments or larger residential developments. The employment center is a designation that is identified for industrial and office uses, but includes a provision to basically support, quote unquote, supportive uses. The institutional district, that is the future land use designation that's most often mapped over county facilities, churches, some parks, hospitals. The commercial future land use designation, that's a traditional retail environment. That's a designation you'll find a lot along Route 3 and Route 1. The low density residential is your traditional neighborhood, that's the wrong term to use. It's your typical suburban development pattern. It's probably resembles the neighborhood that you live in. When you go home, you're likely going to a normal neighborhood with a low density residential future land use designation.
Excuse me,
yes,
question.
Yes, sir.
This low density, 4 units per acre, this is county water and sewer we're talking about?
It wouldn't have to be. The low density residential, it's likely that, but not guaranteed that.
Okay. The older neighborhoods, I lived in one that there were 4 or 5 per acre and everybody had water and sewer, but I thought we had to have 2 or 3 acres where we could build a house of water and sewer. What's the acreage we have to build a house with water and sewer?
Well, that's more dependent on.
Well, excuse me, with septic and well.
That's dependent on the zoning district. Most of the county that lies outside of the PDB is zoned A2 or A3. Mm-hmm. The A2, for example, has a, I'm thinking a min, it's five acres in A2, and I'm thinking it was 10 in A3.
Okay.
And the rural zoning district is 3. The low density residential future land use designation, though, could hypothetically have any of those zoning districts underlying it. The properties that lie within a future, within a low density residential future land use designation are going to be zoned one of those other of those other zoning designations.
So you're saying these 4 units here on an acre could have their own well and sewer? I mean, their own well and septic? Is that what we're saying?
It's the way the comprehensive plan is set up, it doesn't guarantee someone a density of 4 units per acre. It kind of hypothesizes that 4 units per acre is going to be the general density.
Yeah, but I don't think you're hearing my question.
Okay, try it again.
You got out in the county, you got to have 5 acres to have a well and septic tank, right? You're saying right here we can have 4 units per acre in this place right here and have a well and septic tank.
Well, there are other future land use designations that are more likely mapped outside of the primary development boundary where there aren't public utilities. for example, the rural or the agricultural. We'll get to a few maps shortly.
Really saying is these four units here are going to be in county water and sewer.
Yes, right? The low-density residential, if you look at the future land use map, the areas that are designated as low-density residential are all within the primary development boundary.
Okay, thank you.
Outside of those, you'll frequently find either rural or agricultural future land use designations where county water and sewer are not available. The rural designations largely mapped over farms, forest lands. It's intended to support those as well as large lot residential and some cluster development. The agricultural and forestal district is largely mapped over agricultural and forestal lands. And lastly, open space is a designation that's mapped over areas that are owned by the county, the Commonwealth, federal owners, or areas that are generally intended to be preserved in perpetuity. Countywide, the bulk of the county is rural. It's outside, it has a rural future land use designation. It's not served by county water or sewer services. The breakdown of the lands and their future land use designations is mapped up in the top left-hand corner of the screen. If we look closer at the PDB, one of the things we'll notice is that there's very little of that area that has that rural designation because we're looking for higher densities. So those properties within the PDB are typically one of three things. They're typically either low-density residential, employment center, or mixed use. At a previous meeting, the Planning Commission asked what percentage of the primary of property in the primary development boundary was remaining to be built out. Over the past few months, we've been working with the Utilities Department in an effort to update their water and sewer demand projections, which kind of involved answering the same question. Further, we're also looking to estimate how those properties in the PDB will build out in the future. We're still tuning the last part, how they'll build out, but we have a pretty good, we have a close estimate of the actual vacancy in the PDB. The estimate was done with the methodology I'm showing before you. Generally, we started with every property in the PDB and removed those that were improved, and then also removed any that were entitled with an existing approval. By that, I mean any that already had a site plan that wasn't built out or a rezoning that wasn't built out. We then removed any parcel that was in a conservation easement or an open space. We removed public lands, and we were left with parcels that are, loosely put, privately developable, unimproved, and that don't have existing plans. That resulted in these. The primary development boundary, by the initial calculations, is approximately one-third vacant. That vacancy can be broken down. If you look at how those parcels, what the future land use designation of those parcels are, that's summarized in that table in the top left corner. Note, again, it's primarily consists of three: the mixed use designation, the employment center designation, and the low-density residential designation.
Excuse me, just for clarification.
Yes, sir.
What you're saying here is these primary development districts here, is still 33% of them are still vacant. So only two-thirds of this question we've asked earlier has been developed.
That is our current estimate. Yeah, there's about one-third remaining that's vacant.
Okay, thank you. And I don't know that you can answer this question. Over what period of time did it take this two-thirds to be developed? I don't think you can put a number on that, but it's a curious question. Gives you an idea how long it's going to take to fill out the rest of it.
Yeah, I mean, really, you know, about 1970, before 1970, the population, I don't remember off the top of my head what it was, but it was very small, and then after that it started to grow, and then you got into the 80s and 90s, and it started to really grow. So, you know, I think I would look at this from about 1970 until now as the time period to have developed.
But we've been adding to this primary development area ever since then, too.
Yes, it has expanded, true.
So we still got a third to go. Thank you.
One of the things we did observe in the creation of in the analysis of this, we did find that there were obviously some of these parcels that are displayed here are going to develop as single-family homes. And it was pretty easy to pick those out. We were able to find lots that were an appropriate size and appropriate zoning, and more importantly, they were within an existing subdivision. We found about 400 of those in before getting to the that are included on this screen. The other thing I wanted to highlight here is obviously the pattern. The core of the primary development boundary is built out, or it has plans already approved. It's our the properties that are located to the south in Thornburg, throughout the Jackson Gateway, and to the east through 17, heading out towards New Post, that largely remain vacant. That probably doesn't surprise anyone here. Unfortunately, one of the things we also learned in working with the utilities department to figure this out was that there were also some parcels that were included in the primary development boundary, but challenging to serve for one, usually due to elevation problems. And Director Parrish has that leg of the presentation.
This map was prepared by the Utilities Department to show these areas that are within the primary development boundary that are difficult to serve. They are the areas depicted in purple. So just flipping back to this map, you'll see this stretch of mixed use along here. That's generally this stretch along here. So along Smith Station Road, on the opposite side of Smith Station Road, north of Route 3, we've got an area. And this is a parcel that's currently owned by a timber company. It's the one that's accessed by the bridge over I-95. And that's its only access point. But so these are all areas that, because of topography, they are difficult to serve. So in meeting with the utilities department, they indicated, yes, they are within our primary development boundary. Yes, they could be served. But most likely, they would be served because of a large development that comes forward that could fund the necessary infrastructure to serve that area. The utilities department is not planning to extend the utilities out to those areas simply to serve them. It's going to have to come because of larger developments that come forward over time.
Is that something that's proffered then? Is that in accordance with the proffer law we have, or how does that happen?
Yeah, well, typically what happens with water and sewer is that developers will partner with the utilities department, work with them to figure out the best solution on how to provide the water and sewer, and they'll end up doing a cost share so that if the developer oversizes the pipes in order to accommodate development down south of them, the utilities department will pay the difference. So yes, it's something that happens outside of the proffer process and is kind of standard operating procedures. So that, you know, that generally describes the situation in these areas. And some of the areas are a little bit easier to serve. Some of them are a little bit tougher to serve. There is one area up here that is going to be very difficult to serve. And actually, a bit of it is actually already developed. This is up in the Ashley Farms area. What the situation is here is that there is an area here that's owned by the Civil War Trust under conservation easement. And then you've got all of this existing development within here. And then you'd end up up at the vacant parcels at the northern end where you're almost up to River Road. So these are areas that potentially are impossible to serve because of all the obstacles in the way in being able to bring the sewer north along here. So some approaches to consider with this comprehensive plan update. The focus is on growing efficiently and preserving our primary development boundary. So we do have areas within our primary development boundary that, because of the issues with extending sewer, they're currently developing. There's an example on Smith Station Road where there are 19 lots that have been platted. They're going to be on well and septic. The sewer just wouldn't work. It wasn't at a location that the ordinance could require it. So we have those 19 lots developing on well and septic, and that's not the most efficient use of our land within our primary development boundary if we want to continue to keep the primary development boundary fairly tight and preserve the rural character of the rest of the county. So the area that may be almost impossible to serve, it might just be worthwhile to go ahead and shrink the primary development boundary at that location so as not to, give the false impression that that's an area that we're encouraging growth in the future. The other areas, really it's just the one area north of Route 3 that is under that. But other areas where, yes, it can be, it's difficult, it would have to be a larger development that comes forward. There's a concept in the comprehensive plan years ago called the transition district. And basically, it was the outer year development area. And so basically, what happened was there are some policies in the plan that set it up, said, yes, this is within our core area we'd like to develop, but it shouldn't be what develops now. This is what should develop in the outer years because of the constraints and because of where it's located. And so essentially you're not leapfrogging over developable areas now in order to develop areas that could be served with water and sewer in the future. So that's an idea that I'd like to throw out to the Planning Commission to see, you know, what your thoughts are in terms of trying to designate these areas. Allow, if a big project comes along in the near term that's willing and able to sewer and support it, then great, but not allow for it to be piecemeal, smaller projects, eat up the land, and then you'd have to go in the future and expand your primary development boundary beyond another area that's a large area of well and septic and leapfrog that in order to provide another utility system.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Where is that piece of property at? It's hard to tell by this map.
Yeah, so this is like Ashley Farms was up in this area. This is Spotswood Furnace Road here. This is River Road.
And how much land, how much acreage is that?
I don't know offhand how many acres this is.
Well, I guess my question, if we did that, then would they be able to come in and put houses in there on well and septic?
Well, part of it already is developing out residentially on well and septic, but there are a couple of larger parcels still up there. They could, under their current zoning, come in for, you know, if they're zoned rural, which they may be in that location, they could come in with a development that has 3-acre lots, but a maximum of 10 lots on a single parcel, and develop it by right on well and septic, yes. Otherwise, they could propose a rezoning.
Okay, thank you.
And I guess I'm trying to wrap my head around the issue with servicing these areas. Is it because they would require pump stations and we want to get out of the pump station business?
Yes.
Is that really the...
Yes, it would add burden to the public infrastructure to maintain that.
That would include privately... Do we allow privately owned pump stations tying... I don't know if we do. Is that a utility?
Yeah, I don't know off the top of my head.
Yeah. And has the utility department, as this primary development boundary grows, have they indicated any life cycle or costs or anything with, like, wastewater treatment plants and some of those other things that, you know,
do you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I'll touch on that. That information will be published in their update. They're working on updating their, for lack of a better term, master plan, and that information would be in there. I don't have that in front of me, but I can certainly get you a copy of the draft.
Yeah. Have they expressed any concern with, you know, the growth of the PDB in regards to their infrastructure, or is it just...
The major, I would say that their major concerns are identified on this map.
And that being the pump stations to...
It just being the properties that they've determined to be challenging to serve and mapped in purple.
Okay. So Wanda,
let me ask you a question there. All right, you stated that if a large development came in, mm-hmm. you know, that they possibly would put in the utilities that are needed in that, you know. But we didn't want to go and allow smaller developments because that would not put in the utilities that would be warranted in that area. Am I correct?
Right, small developments on well and septic, because okay. then you're sort of eating up your primary development boundary with well and septic and potentially having to leapfrog over it in the future to provide the sewer system.
All right, so a larger development would come in, and Ms. County Attorney, listen to this, please, and tell me also. Okay, so a larger development comes in, and they want to rezone it. And we approve the rezoning because of the utilities that would be needed in that area, okay? But we would have several of the smaller developments to come in for rezoning, and we turned it down. Would that be legal?
There would be policies. What I'm proposing to do is have a series of policies within the comprehensive plan. And of course, you know, if a project came along that was generally consistent with the rest of the plan and the board ultimately wanted to approve it, they could approve it. But we would have policies in here that would support our desire to preserve our primary development boundary for water and sewer served developments.
That would take care of it, and that would be legal. They come up with something different.
Ms. Carter, all due respect, that is not a question I will answer off the cuff. So when we get to the point where policies are put in place as we're looking to that, if that becomes an issue, Ms. Parrish will send a request for legal opinion over to our office, and we will be happy to look into it.
Yes, because it's something we have to be very careful of. And, I mean, we know that. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So if the Planning Commission is amenable, yes.
One question, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Going back up into this piece of property, if we did this and took this out, does that affect the property value at all?
I'd have to look into that. I don't know how being within the primary development boundary but not being served by water and sewer, I'd have to check with the assessment office to see how that factors into their values.
I would think, just thinking out loud, that would affect it. I mean, because you certainly could put more houses in if we had the county sewer and water versus putting well and septic. Am I correct? They could put more houses.
Absolutely.
So
yes.
So it affects their property value somewhat.
But if you physically can't get the water and sewer to that location, then that's not going to help improve your property values.
So they're saying that. They cannot get it there, even with the help of a developer.
This area, the northern one, is really a physical barrier situation, okay. more so than, as well as the drainage. But the physical barrier is the one that's very difficult to overcome. Maybe not impossible, but it's very difficult. You got the Civil War Trust property spanning Route 3 through that whole area, so. So what I'm looking for this evening is, before we work on this, just feedback from the Planning Commission. Would you like us to work on this concept, bring it back to you for consideration, if in the fact you review what we come up with and you decide you'd rather just leave it as it is, we can just back off of that. But before I spend time working on trying to come up with some policies and try to go in this direction that's a little bit different, just want to be sure that you want me to do that.
Well, policies in and of themselves concern me, just for being policies. But I'm very interested in it, Wanda, and how we project growth over the 10 years. What is hot? Like, we've seen an awful lot of apartment buildings. I mean, where are we going with mm-hmm. with our growth and tempering that with keeping our rural nature. I for one, would encourage you to do that. And I open up the floor to other comments, but yeah, I think it's needed information. And I'm not sure where I'm going with this question, but the PDB and its growth, I'd like to see some statistics on, you know, where we were originally, say 10 years ago, and where we are now with the different uses within the PDB, where we intended, say, a employment center that's now a residential, or I guess it's rezonings is what I'm, I think, talking about. But where we were 10 years ago as a plan, and where we are now, and where we're going is really what I'm asking.
Okay.
So, if I'm clear.
Well, you have there, consider shrinking PDB north of Route 3. What are you going to do with Route 1? Let it continue to?
Right, so the area along Route 1 and along Smith Station Road, those would be the areas where we would probably put a hatching over the areas that are difficult to serve. They'd still be within our primary development boundary.
Yeah.
They'd still be designated under their future land use designation for higher density growth. But we'd be looking for a longer-term development period and focus the nearer-term development a little bit closer into the core.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One other thing I'd like to add, too, is within areas that are already developed, the more built-up, dense areas, I have a sense we're starting to see some applications that change, rezonings that, you know, were for a higher density where we're rebuilding in the more dense areas. I'd like to get a flavor for where we're going with that, too. If you have any opinion on that, I'd like to see that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like the townhouse,
yes,
development,
exactly.
On Hudgens.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
So the next thing I just wanted to share with you, this is really just for informational purposes. You can know what requests we've received from property owners at this point to consider expansions to the primary development boundary. This proposal before you, this is actually closer up maps that show the difficult to serve areas. So this actually shows that there are quite a few lots in the area already. Forgot I had these. So this is the actual requests for expansions to the primary development boundary. And so this is the first one. This is in the 5 Mile Road area, north of Plank Road, and this is 5 Mile Road. And there's a request in for these two parcels here. This is an area that's a little bit odd because you can see the primary development boundary comes down here and then hugs Route 3 pretty close. But we do have this little extension. This was done as part of a comprehensive plan amendment that comes up around Barley Woods. And then you see we have quite a bit of higher density and intensity development happening in this area that's outside of the primary development boundary. I know that back when we did the comprehensive plan update last time, there was a request from a property owner, I think in this general, was it right in here somewhere? In this general area to expand the primary development boundary, but that wasn't, that did not move forward. So this request is, it's a little bit discontiguous here, but we are, every request we're receiving, we're going ahead and forwarding them to the utilities department for evaluation so that they can, each of them be considered. So this one is in the Cortland District. The other two are in the Berkeley District. This is Summit Crossing Road here. And Massaponics Church Road is up off the screen here with Cedar Forest Elementary here. And so the request is this small rural zoned property that's tucked in this corner of the employment land use area. So, you know, it doesn't look like it has road frontage, but the request has come in for that one. And then the
excuse me, Wanda, you said the request has come in to change this designation?
To include, to take this this dashed line here is our primary development boundary, so their request is to move the primary development boundary around this parcel.
Are we allowed to know who asked this?
I don't know off the top of my head. Do you
is this a citizen or a developer?
This is a Spotsylvania County resident who is the landowner of that piece of property. I don't know what his, in this particular instance, I don't know of it as a developer. I believe his name, I don't want to get it wrong. There's
That's
a Mr. Kiley. I believe it might be a Mr. Kiley, if I'm not mistaken. We could provide that information to you.
And he wants to be in this primary development district?
He is interested in the primary development district. As is most of the time when we see these type of requests, and in this instance, we have three thus far. They're property owners who are interested. They're either courting a development prospect and they want the ability to have public water and sewer at some point in the future. So that's their primary reasons for trying to be incorporated into the primary development boundary. In this particular case, the question was asked, frankly, if you could see the way the line was drawn, the question came, why was I left out? Why am I in the middle of this and I was left out? It's a good question. There are some policies where if you can gravity feed into the primary development boundary and you're actually physically out of it, there is actually potential utility policy that would enable you to get your sewer services that way. But
you would have to be adjoining
you'd have to be
PDB.
Yeah. And that is the case here. But I think what happens is because we're outside the PDB, you have a rural residential land use, so that doesn't promote a rezoning effort to something more high density like employment center, which is in it. So I think property owners get concerned or nervous that, you know, you're not going to support a development prospect in my location. And I would feel safer if I was included within the primary development boundary. That's ultimately where it comes down to.
Well, I just have one other statement. Should we do this now or wait till this guy comes to us and has a project and then we switch him up? That's my question.
In that instance, it would be an applicant-driven comprehensive plan amendment outside of this process. Oftentimes, when we do the comprehensive plan amendments, we do get these requests because we're kind of in process. But, yeah, they could certainly request the comprehensive plan amendment specific to their location. I will tell you from previous examples, though, we tend to look beyond the limits of a specific parcel. In this case, it's 5 acres in size. We tend to look at the actual area that could potentially be served based on the topography. So we'll look at this parcel, but we may actually look at what's the larger area here that could really be served.
So this is 5 acres?
That one right there is 5 acres. It's currently zoned rural, and it has a rural residential land use.
So currently, how many homes can be on that right now?
It's one dwelling unit per 3 acres, so you basically have one parcel.
And if we change that, we have county water and sewer there, then what?
If we're looking at this as a specific type of, well, first of all, I don't know if we would go to a higher residential land use simply because we have employment center all adjacent to this. It may be. We're looking at that specifically. My gut would say we would probably include it in a mixed use or employment center land use because of the land use designations that are already there. But hypothetically, being on the edge of the primary development boundary, trying to step down to the rural area, I would say you'd probably be looking at like a low-density residential, one dwelling unit per four, or four dwelling units per acre. That's what you'd be looking at.
And the last request is, this is New Post here. And it's the area that is south of Route 17. This is the area that's currently being quarried, the sand and gravel operation. And so the request has been for this area, consideration of the area south of 17. And so that is also just being reviewed, and we'll be back in the future to discuss that in more detail. And we'll have the utility staff here at that time so that they can address it.
And just a general question in regards to traffic. When we talk comprehensive plan or changes in the PDB, I assume that we have discussions and coordinate with FAMPO and other regional transportation authorities.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yes, okay. We will.
Yes, our excuse me, our travel demand model that is operated by our traffic engineer out of the planning department. What he does is he feeds in all of these land uses in order to develop trip generations appropriate to the land uses, and so he will need to update his model if changes are made to our future land use map or our boundary. So anyways, I already mentioned this and that we're simply in the process of receiving and evaluating any requests that we receive from property owners on a case-by-case basis. You know, in the end, it could be that the Planning Commission and the board decide they don't want to entertain any of them. They could entertain some of them. Some of them just might not be feasible. So we'll just keep you updated on that as we move forward. Jacob is up now.
All right, good evening. So my focus this evening is going to be doing kind of a zoom-in session on the future land use map designation specifically. I'm going to keep this within the primary development boundary, which is the focus of tonight's meeting. The focus of this is to focus on the uses, the character of development and development mix that we what our community expects in certain areas of the county. And there are three core areas that I'd like to focus on this evening. And they're specifically due to high profile locations, available developable land. As Patrick had stated earlier in the presentation, the Jackson Gateway Thornburg area has a good deal of developable land under the employment center and mixed use designation. As Wanda had also stated, the mixed use area is currently in question in terms of how readily it can be served by public water and sewer. The second area being the exit 126 area here, central Spotsylvania primary development boundary, Route 1 corridor, I-95 access, highly visible, a lot of I-95 spin-off type of businesses in these areas, and economic development prospects. If you've recently read in the newspaper, one of our recent developers in the South Point Parkway area even referred to this as a potential development of essentially a mini city area for the county. And then thirdly, I'd like to focus on the Crossroads area where we have some existing development, mixed use approved projects. They haven't necessarily developed mixed use yet, but are planned to do so. And there is readily developable mixed use as well as employment center lands in these areas. So those are the main focus areas. I would also like to point to the fact that these are also gateways to the county. The first area at Thornburg at exit 118 and also at the Caroline County boundary itself. The second area at 126, a gateway to the county for out-of-town traffic, tourists, same thing with 118, visiting hotels, first impressions to the county. And then the third one being the VRE station, and if not, at least now, in the future, hopefully, when we start bringing tourists and folks down this way via VRE. So the first area I'm going to focus on this evening is on the Jackson Gateway and Thornburg area. The question that we'd like to pose to you, first of all, reflecting back on Wanda's comments, that this mixed-use area introduces the concept of high-density residential or higher-density residential down in the Thornburg area of the county. The mixed-use designation, which is a higher-density land use, is immediately adjacent to rural residences as well as the Indian Acres campground. So it is a consideration, and again, this is an area that is considered a bit difficult to serve and it may take time to implement. Secondly, it has to do with the development mix of the Jackson Gateway. This has oftentimes been envisioned as a large employment center, an area for industrial growth, high technology type of operations, office development. And right now, the employment center land use designation is extremely broad. So you could potentially bring in a Class A office project, a industrial three type, heavy industrial operation with emissions, a technology park, a very large entertainment center, amusement park in there, anything that tends to create jobs. And you potentially have an issue where you have development kind of going in different directions or potentially conflicting with one another. And what we're asking this evening is what the actual vision is for how the Jackson Gateway and Thornburg area will ultimately develop, and whether the employment center designation, which is, like I said, extremely broad, should be reined in, generally speaking, across the county, or perhaps certain employment center type uses, whether they be distribution centers, high technology, or some sort of other employment center and office park, are kind of geolocated to different areas of the county. So there's different ways to go about it, but we do have a question on that because it has been an issue in the past. Second area that we like to focus on, there's an opportunity within the exit 126 area. Just getting into the transportation element of the comprehensive plan, for instance, we do have planned road extensions at Germana Point Drive. There's also a Market Street extension that would ultimately tie up with Hood Drive and open up undeveloped lands currently south of Hood Drive. I believe some of this is up for sale presently. But we have a mix of land use designations identified here. A lot of the employment center areas are already developed as industrial park areas. Some of the commercial areas have been recently questioned. I believe the board supported looking at essentially a revitalization study, looking at the Route 1 corridor between Market Street or Exit 126 and I believe Mine Road, or maybe even further above than that, to try to improve the look of that area and promote reinvestment of some of those of that corridor. I know from a business walk that occurred last year with the economic development staff, the Economic Development Department has localized business walks in certain areas of the county, and one of the concerns of the businesses in that area expressed was the condition of the Route 1 corridor as essentially inhibiting business or keeping people away. So that is an area that we'd like to focus on, and as well as what the intended land uses are in that area. With I-95 frontage as extensive as it is here, with undeveloped land, you know, is that something that we want to have a bunch of townhomes along I-95, or do we want to have multi-story office buildings with corporate logos and kind of showing an economic force along the I-95 corridor? So what's the ultimate vision within the 4 Mile Fork area down exit 126? These are some of the big questions that we have at this point. And again, the big concern that's being raised here is how varied our land use for mixed use as well as employment centers, how broad those definitions can be, and trying to rein in what the actual vision is.
The vision has always been that we would like very much to bring the workforce from Northern Virginia to here.
Yep.
And it hasn't happened.
Yep.
And we keep talking about utilities, water and sewer. One of the biggest hurdles that we have is transportation. You know, we focus these things, and you think that big industries are going to come in. They're not going to come in if they can't move their goods or whatever they have. I mean, that's just not going to happen. And it's not going to happen, and it's not fair to the people that live in that area. When are we going to start focusing more on how we can move the traffic there? If this is what we're going to focus on, commercial, and I agree. Industrial, I agree. That's what the property is zoned for. And then, of course, you got to have residential to go along with these things. And we say work, play, and whatever, live. But, however, we could sit here and plan all day long, but if we can't move the traffic, we haven't done anything.
Yeah, getting back to an earlier point, one of the issues is funding and the implementation of these projects. We have a lot of projects that have identified, such as that Germana Point Drive extension, which we actually recently applied for smart scale funding for, and hopefully the county will be able to be granted that. A lot of these transportation questions can be, from a comprehensive plan standpoint, will be addressed as part of the transportation element update, where we're looking to actually start prioritizing potentially these projects going forward and really focus where these projects are implemented. But I absolutely agree with you. Transportation infrastructure is a huge key component mm-hmm. to this. Additionally, I would say identifying land uses that we can support that ultimately get what we're looking for. One of the things about employment center, for instance, is if you have a large distribution center with large truck fleets, you may want to try to, via policy at least, promote that they're located within a certain service shed of I-95, so they're not across the county and have to truck across existing infrastructure to get to I-95. If they're located closer to I-95 in the get-go, they're not hitting as many county roads and beating them up as much either. So it's those type of little policy things that we could try to help as projects are laid out and proposed, at least from a comprehensive plan standpoint, identify those pros and cons. So if a large industrial operation comes in with a big truck fleet in the Thornburg area or Jackson Gateway, it's located along Route 1 corridor near I-95 exit, probably a much better situation than being located out Route 3 somewhere near Chancellor Road. So those are the type of things that we're trying to do. The issue that I have from a comprehensive plan standpoint is we are looking at the land use chapter separately at this point, but we are trying to be cognizant of transportation, but I am trying to focus on the land use itself.
My concern is just what I just said, is that we've been looking at this for years and years and years, but we haven't looked at the transportation issue as strongly as what we need to support this. And anyway.
It's funding.
Well, it is funding, and that's a big part of it. I would say to Mr. Newhouse's point, though, I think we have earlier today, the question about how consistent our rezoning activity has been over the last 5 to 10 years, say, with our land use designations. I would say, actually, our land use designations have been, the projects that have come forward have generally been supported because the land use proposed are lining up quite well. That could be to do with how broad the land use definitions are, that it catches so many, such a wide array of uses that there's no, it sets up a situation where you potentially actually have conflicting uses. But we have a rezoning history map that we've been tracking since 2009, and we track all our active or approved rezoning since that time, and they're geolocated based on the future land use map, and we'll be happy to share that with you.
That would be excellent. And to Ms. Carter's point, that was why I was asking about coordination with FAMPO on our planning. And you, Jacob, you raised the exact point why I was wondering what our future trends are in growth, because to me that speaks to how we plan this out. And your point is exactly right. If I own a trucking company, I don't want to be out on 3. I want to be close to 95 and interchange where I can get fleet in and out very effectively and efficiently versus, downtown where I just can't get to it. So, again, our focus is good quality paying jobs, quality of life, all those things that we attracted us to Spotsylvania County in the first place, why we're here, and be smart about how we grow. I shy away from policies as a general rule, but I think we can structure something that, provides us guidance to where we want to go in our growth areas.
And he's right when he says FAMPO, which is very true. I mean, that's where it begins. And, of course, FAMPO is Planning District 16. And in that Planning District 16, you have the city, okay? And so sometimes the counties, and the city do not jive together. One's pulling one way and one's pulling another way. And we never get anything done unless they pull together. Well, to me, if you got a commercial and industrial employment centers here, Fredericksburg can't handle this, but we can. But that's jobs for their residents also. Yep. And I mean, so they should all be, that's what we need to focus on. Do you want jobs for your residents? Okay. So I hope they would say yes. And if they said yes, then they should be more congenial and help with the transportation issue.
So what we'll be looking at rather than policies are strategies.
That's my yes. suggestion, more strategies wanted versus policies. I am adverse to policies, but a good sound strategy is an excellent way to put it.
All right, and then I'm going to move on to the last focus area this evening on the future land use map, and then in that case we're going to focus on the Crossroads area on VRE station. I would say the VRE station is depicted right in this area here, Route 17 corridor. Majority of this area that's undeveloped is either identified as mixed use or employment center. One of the comments I would like to bring up where we went through the future land use designations is we have a lot of, there are the vacant parcels, and where this was one of the areas where there was a lot of vacant parcels. Some of these areas may not fully build out as they may be construed to build out. You know, this is a large swath of Purple Employment Center. You do have to consider things like wetlands, and there's extensive wetlands in this area presently, so that inhibits it to some extent. The request that we have from development community actually is to potentially shift the mixed use area to include these areas out to Thornton Rolling Road and then southward towards Summit Crossing Road to expand the mixed use area upon all this employment center area. I would note in terms of accessibility, it's very limited. You're either looking at long roads in from Crossroads Parkway or Massaponix Church Road or up through Summit Crossing Road to get to these lands. They haven't developed, you know, since the 2008 comprehensive plan when the employment center land use was designated in this area. Mixed use has been fairly popular, but again, employment center tends to be your exclusive office parks or high-tech industrial parks, office parks, things like that. Mixed use introduces a residential component, and we've seen a number of instances where residential becomes kind of the lead-in project.
You're hitting the point that I'm concerned about is far too often, in my opinion, with these mixed use, especially rezoning packages, is the residential just is far too out ahead of the commercial part of it. And that's a concern. And I know it's a concern of other commission members. That's something that we need to work on, so yeah.
One thing I did note, and I'll wrap it up, I swear it. just passionate about these things, I guess.
You're doing
I only
well.
Get to do this once every 5 years, so we're in the comp plan again.
Yeah.
This is my third one now.
Yeah, yeah.
So anyway, within Spotsylvania County, there is actually, if you really think about it, there's limited rail siding in the county.
Yeah.
A lot of the rail siding that we have is either already developed or it's tied up in national parkland or Slaughter Pen Farm, which is industrially zoned, but it's not going to develop industrial. It's under conservation, it's ownership. And then there are the other extensive corridors that are all in, you know, sensitive wetland areas. There's a Superfund site in there as well. So there's only a few locations where we actually have rail siding, and from a industrial attraction standpoint, it may not, and I reached out to our economic development staff recently about that. It's not regular that we have industrial operators who are looking for rail access. But it can happen, and when you have a limited amount of it available, you may want to try to preserve that. The only thing that we, and I'm not saying it's absolutely sure that it could happen yet, there's studies that have to be made, but as we consider expanding the mixed-use area potentially, the rail siding along this corridor, we may want to consider leaving in an employment center type of designation. That's not to say that mixed use couldn't happen, but I don't know that we would want to see residential along the tracks anyway, or promote that necessarily. So it may be, you know, we have a VRE rail yard maintenance center down there right now, which is industrially zoned. So there is a consideration for rail siding in this particular area that we may also want to consider as we consider this mixed use.
Does industrial include high-tech data centers, things like this?
It would. I mean, our Industrial 1 and Industrial 2 zoning districts, one of the issues that We do have very flexible zoning districts in some way. So industrial can actually go on and away from different commercial type of operations. I don't know if it goes as far as commercial retail, but it may even include commercial retail all the way to industrial one, industrial two, and industrial three, which are considered more nuisance industries that require a special use. But yeah, that can go on anyway. Paint manufacturing, the high tech technology, slaughterhouses. Industrial is a pretty wide distribution centers, high tech, you know, chip manufacturing, things like that.
So I guess one of the strategies moving forward is the different type of industrial uses. You know, the sexy thing today are the tech centers and the data centers and those types of things, and how that works into our plan. I would love to see something like that in the area, but
and that is something we've actually heard, you know, over the years as well, where we have an industrial park where the land use may support industrial, but a metal recycling products center wants to open up within that industrial park, which is industrial, and it, from a land use perspective, it sounds like good, it goes in industrial park, but then you have the existing industrial users saying that, whoa, this is counter to what we bought into within this industrial park. So you end up with these conflicts.
Yep, exactly.
So our observations, there are a significant number of undeveloped parcels in the primary development boundary with mixed use and employment center designations. Of those undeveloped parcels, roughly 75% of them are mixed use and employment center. Again, in the Jackson Gateway, Thornburg, and Crossroads areas are the core areas of that. The employment center designation is broadly defined. Mixed use lacks density limitations. Mixed use designation offers support for a wide range of uses. It's also broadly defined in development proposals. It tends to be very flexible in that. And mixed use areas are diverse physically and geographically separated, but tend to lack specific vision as to an intended build out. So there's different mixed use areas, but right now it's kind of one size fits all in terms of how they're described. So for considerations that we'd like to pass along, to consider adding more specificity to...
All right, keep going.
Sorry. To the employment... I'm getting dried out. To the employment center land use category by adding goals or policies that better guide the locations of commercial, office, and industrial uses. To add new language describing how the mixed-use areas are envisioned to develop. To potentially set or consider density maximums or goals. The mixed-use areas are created from a tapestry of uses within the district. If you look at the hospital area, you have a wide variety of singular uses that are geographically located adjacent to one another, and that's building out nicely. Or you have, like, the village, where you have vertically stacked. There's identification of core areas within mixed-use districts to help direct development density and transitions. If you have a core district within a large mixed area, this is where you can expect potentially vertical mixed. But as you transition out to your lower-density residential around the periphery, it may not be appropriate to have tall buildings. You may want single-family residences or townhomes. Other zoning districts than the mixed-use area are compatible with these districts. We just want to clarify that. You could potentially be within a mixed-use land-use area. You don't necessarily have to pursue a mixed-use zoning district. There are PDHs, there are commercials, there are a variety of, there's office zoning districts that could potentially be pursued and work within a mixed-use district.
So, without objection, to what we presented to tonight as to what we propose to focus on and work on. That's our plan, is to work on those areas we've discussed this evening, focus on some of those areas, focus on employment center, mixed use, better define them, and then those primary development boundary areas. And then just also to let you know some of the other things we've been working on behind the scenes. We're working towards when we had the joint work session with the Board of Supervisors, the Board of Supervisors expressed interest in being very involved in the transportation element of the plan. So we're working towards having a work session with the Board of Supervisors, probably the first meeting in October. And at that meeting, transportation staff will be talking with them about prioritizing our project list, coming up with a priority list, and then coming up with a process that everyone agrees to, that when they want to consider a change to the priority list or propose a new project
be put into the mix, how that process would work, because right now you might end up with, you know, a project come up from one area that suddenly rises to the top as a priority, and others feel like their priorities are not being considered. So we'd like to formalize that process, and also, you know, just talk to them about the chapter in general. But Jacob has been doing a lot of work on the appendices in our current comprehensive plan that include all of that inventory data that's required by the Code of Virginia. He's been going through and updating all of that environmental information. There are changes, actually, that will need to occur to our chapter related to environmental due to the Chesapeake Bay Act. As they're doing their review, they have identified a few items within our comprehensive plan that they feel are missing. So we'll be bringing that forward as well as part of this.
Are you privy to any information on how the Ches Bay Act is performing?
I am not familiar with it. Our environmental engineer would definitely be Richard Street.
Yeah, I'll get a hold of Richard. I'm interested to see how that's mm-hmm. working.
Yeah. And so those are, I think, the highlights. Public facilities. I forgot about public facilities. We've reached out to each of the departments and agencies that are in charge of various types of public facilities, provided them with their section of the chapter, asked them to review it and update it, and provide their recommendations to us on how to improve it. We've been having some individual meetings with some of the different groups. So we are working on the public facilities element as well, and we'll start to bring forward pieces of that for the Planning Commission to review the text. And we'll invite the appropriate departments or agencies to be present for answering questions during that period as well. I think we've got the libraries just about teed up. Parks and Recreation is going to be fairly close, and solid waste. So we've been making quite a bit of progress behind the scenes. So you're going to start to see a little bit more coming towards you that's actually written document for you to provide feedback on.
Excellent. Anything else, Wanda?
That's it.
Well, I appreciate the great work you folks are doing. That was very informative. Appreciate it. Keep it up. Next up on the agenda is any new business. I don't believe we have any tonight. Next, I'll open it up to public comment. If we have speakers this evening, the same rules apply with the podium. I would just ask that you respect that. So I'll open up the floor.
I believe it says Harvey McNamara followed by David Hammond. Or actually, it's Nancy, I'm sorry. Nancy McNamara.
That's all right. I'll take any name. Thank you. Thank you. Good evening. And thanks for the very good presentation on planning, even though it was long, but it was good. My name is Nancy McNamara, Livingston District. And yesterday at the Board of Supervisors, citizens from varying areas of Spotsylvania gave convincing evidence of substantial problems related to special use permit for a solar plant in Spotsylvania. If the biblical prayer, he who has eyes, ears to hear, let him hear, has relevance in our lives, we can only hope that truth will prevail in an era, where the media, lobbyists, and wealth control the information decision makers receive and use when making decisions. Citizens continue to present evidence of problems related to erosion, water runoff, and land devastation. They continue to ask about management plans and quality control. The supervisors were shown how the project is chiefly a method for supposedly politically correct business executives to become wealthy through tax credit methodology. Meanwhile, the earth becomes a wasteland at decommission time. How can an honest public servant listen and hear in this environment? Why was the unbiased consultant, who is an expert on solar projects, not offered an interview when he applied to assist? Will you confer with the Culpeper County, who just rejected several solar applications? What happened to the 2002 comprehensive plan and report on water resources in Spotsylvania? And I have a copy of that plan, which have relevance to the requirements and potential dangers of this project. Several citizens have mentioned advisory groups. Are you responding to their offer? Many significant questions remain unanswered, which lead to the irreverent thought of hearing aids. The truth for this permit request requires rigorous listening and action. We need a full response to the many questions which have been asked. They keep asking them, and nobody answers. A tentative plan might determine the feasibility of submitting 6,500 acres of land to multiple environmental impact before irreversible damage is done. So I'm asking if people will please listen to the questions, the many questions which have been asked. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
David Hammond, followed by Moya Doss.
Good evening. I spoke last night with the Board of Supervisors. I wanted you to hear the same message. My name is David Hammond. I live in the Livingston District, Spotsylvania County. The recent decision by the State Corporation Commission makes it clear that all of the really important decisions about the S-Power solar project are your responsibility. The SCC approval is conditional on the applicants obtaining local special use permits, state environmental approvals, and paying for the cost of unspecified network upgrades. The SCC final order makes it perfectly clear that they refused to take a position on any of the numerous concerns raised regarding public health and safety, wildlife, and environmental protection. The DEQ will address a couple of concerns, but not the ones that pertain to unprecedented massive scale of the proposed project, not water extraction, not toxic compounds in the panels, not decommissioning and reclamation, not preserving the character of Spotsylvania County, etc. The SCC documented these concerns, but then they abdicated all of the responsibility, stating in their news release, and I'll quote, Spotsylvania County has wide latitude in attaching conditions to the special use permit necessary for a project for concerns not expressed, not explicitly addressed by DEQ recommendations or in the county permit ordinances. In my written comments, I've got an example of this that specifically calls out the aquifer and cadmium. In my opinion, the SEC final order is a document that prepares their future argument that anything that goes wrong due to the unprecedented scale of this project, damage to the aquifer, injury to public health, safety, and welfare, harm to the wildlife, or the environment will all be your fault because you failed to properly assess the risks and set appropriate conditions in the Spotsylvania County special use permit. The decisions that you make about whether this project is allowed to proceed, and if so, how it will be developed, will be part of your personal and collective legacies. Please proceed carefully and decide wisely. Thank you for your time. I'll leave comments.
Moya Doss, and it says she has a PowerPoint.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
If you wouldn't mind stating your voting district when you come up to speak, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Oops. Floor monitor, please.
Sean Fogarty is next also.
Okay. My name is Moya Doss, and I'm in the Livingston District, and I'm here to give you a solar update on the solar center down in Essex, which was first solar power plant built in Essex County on 20 megawatt. It's on 174 acres. And if you look at the top edge, 17 is along the top edge here. This was the ribbon cutting ceremony on January 24th of this year, roughly 6 months ago. They look very happy here, but I don't think they're probably so happy right now. This is a setback that was well off the highway. And just 2 weeks after that ribbon cutting ceremony, they had a half inch of rain, which caused muddy flooding all over the roads. It was blamed on clear cutting, earth stripping, and inadequate storm runoff provisions. Please note as you look at these slides that the soil here looks much sandier than our red clay mud. And if they're having muddy runoff, imagine what it's going to look like here. And it's also on pretty level ground there, whereas the one here in Spotsylvania is going to be on one of the highest points in the county, which will mean more runoff. This is the visual screening. This is their idea of visual screening off of Route 17 that's currently being planted way after the fact. It's just being done now. These are holly trees that are a mere 2 to 3 feet in height and 15 feet apart and staggered. It'll be years before these trees will screen this solar field from the road. Perimeter control should be installed first, including berms, ponds, plantings to provide permanent stabilization. This ongoing runoff is still a problem. Recently, they had 5 inches of rain. The muddy water runs across the road onto Muddy Gut Road, into Muddy Gut Creek, into the Rappahannock River. And Essex County has just retained the services this past week of a company whose job it is to come up with solutions in Essex for erosion concerns and to keep the runoff from the Rappahannock River. Do no harm is a phrase we've been using often when referring to this project. We need perimeter controls installed before construction. We need proof of concept before S-Power is allowed to move to the second 400-acre parcel. If 174 acres can give Essex County this much trouble, just imagine what 6,350 acres can do to Spotsylvania County. It would take 36 Essex County solar plants to make up the one that's proposed here. Thank you for your time.
Sean Fogarty also has a slideshow, followed by Dan Kulik.
Sean Fogarty from the Livingston District. The county staff is working very, this is mainly a follow-on to the previous presentation from Essex. I've got a few pictures from other projects throughout the country that have experienced erosion issues. The county staff is obviously well aware of this and have asked S-Power for their preference as a 400 acre at a time type of a operation with permanent stabilization as the preference. Up till now, S-Power is saying we'd like to have the option for temporary stabilization, which we think causes the types of problems you saw there in Essex. Here's the picture you just saw from there. This is another site that experienced some muddy runoff type problems. Same site, you just see a chain link fence there that's supposed to be holding back that erosion. Electrical work going on at the same time. In this example, essentially, this has been temporarily stabilized, this project. The types of things that are proposed in that scenario are mulch berms or maybe some swales that are temporary. Clearly, in this operation, they've completed the grading, clearing and grading, and they've installed the stanchions, and they, in S-Power's mind, they would then move on to another 400-acre section, grade and clear, while you have a mess like this to deal with. This is just an example of what could happen if you don't permanently stabilize with vegetation a given area. a couple of slides just to show you some examples of the size of potential size. Here's an example of a silt fence with no berms. Very flat topography here, and that's obviously not the kind of topography we are going to experience out where S-Power is going to build. I did want to get to the last couple, so I'll kind of flip through. These are just examples of construction in progress, cabling being run. This is a site that is quite a bit smaller than what would end up out in the Livingston District. With the service road going down the middle. Again, another example of the small little visual barriers over on the right, which could take probably 20 years to be an actual barrier. These last two slides talk about this project in Rhode Island, which was only 23 acres and experienced quite a bit of muddy mess and runoff. The quote in the newspaper there from the Department of Environmental Management, the guy said, who's the director, said, it's not normal to see such a large site, 23 acres, with the type of grades that this has to be unstabilized in the winter. The reason that this is a problem is because they had construction delays and their project was delayed to the point that they cannot properly implement the plan that was approved to get in and out before the winter came. This is the type of problem we're going to experience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dan Kulik, followed by Irv Boyles.
My name is Daniel Kulik. I live in the Livingston District. Commissioners, in light of the situations you've just looked at, the following conditions are recommended for inclusion in the SUP by the county staff. First and foremost, the rolling 400-acre site development plan proposed by S-Power in their response to the staff's technical letter is much too aggressive for a development of this scale. The maximum of 400-acre development at one time, complete with permanent stabilization, as recommended by the county staff, is the preferred approach and is critical to reduce the risk and maintain control by the county engineers. The approach will require that the construction in the initial area be completed and final grading and seeding be put in place with sufficient growth established. Any temporary stabilization must be replaced by permanent techniques. In addition, the Virginia Erosion and Sediment Control Plan minimum standards checklist shall be completed for each 400-acre plot. The next 400-acre development shall be contingent upon successful completion of the previous parcel. Second, to evaluate the potential existence of acidic soils, it is recommended that the developer be required to conduct a soil sample survey down to the maximum depth of the proposed excavations based on the final grading plan. A sufficient number of samples should be taken as specified by the county inspection authority to ensure adequate coverage. Third, the performance bond required under Section 838 of the County Erosion Control Ordinance shall be equal to the total cost of providing erosion and sediment control improvements for the entire 3,500-acre site. As determined by the county administrator, the performance bond is separate from the decommissioning surety required under the county's solar energy facility ordinance. Fourth, during stormwater-prone months of April through September, the developer shall be required to have a plan in place and be able to execute such plan to contain runoff from an emergent event such as a severe thunderstorm or flash flood scenario. Stormwater calculations should include evaluations of the 4 to 6 inch rains which were encountered in June and July of this year. Fifth, as part of the final erosion and stormwater management plans, the final site plan must address the unique configuration of impervious solar panels constructed over newly established grade. To ensure that this condition is properly addressed for runoff calculations, it is recommended that the final erosion and stormwater management plans for the completed site be certified by an independent civil engineering agent designated by the county and qualified to address this condition. Commissioners, if you only take away one thing from my presentation, please remember that the maximum 400-acre plot at a time development is the key to reducing the risk involved in this massive project. Lessons learned from the first plat will help reduce risks as the project evolves. Thank you.
Thank you.
Irv Boyles, followed by Mike Micheloso.
Good evening. I'm a citizen of the Livingston District. My credentials include 3 Masters of Science degrees, including electrical and electronic engineering and systems management, as well as an MIT degree in management. So I offer my abilities for advisory committee, if you have one. You've heard several of the concerns that we have about this installation. And my point here is to stress the criticality of having in place an acceptable emergency action plan in case of emergencies. I think it is inevitable with the system of systems that we're going to have put on our land out there, we're going to have emergency conditions. And so I would like to emphasize as a condition for your approval of the permit that you have such a plan in place and that it contained all the provisions we need for emergency response and containment to any emergencies that occur so we can protect our citizens of the county and as well as visitors to the our historical landmarks that we have in the area. And I offer a whole list of provisions that should be in that plan. I will be leaving that with the with you and so that you can have a chance to study them. But I'd like to emphasize that it's got to have provisions in there for first responders to be in place quickly after an ability to identify and assess any type of condition that will result in an emergency. This emergency, these incidences, because of the severity of these that can affect people's health, our safety, our security, it's going to be a major issue that needs to be contained and remediation taken as quickly as possible. I've given several examples of this, but and you've heard many reasons, but one thing I want to point out, you've got a 500 megawatt generating plant out here connected into Dominion power that ties into the national electric grid, which is subject to various threats that when you start building up too much power, because when the sun's shining and it's still growing out here, you've got a lot of equipment out here that can very well rupture and be damaged and release toxic materials into the grounds and the waters.
Thank you very much, Mr. Boyles. Time's up. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Mike Micheloso, followed by Kevin McCarthy.
My name is Mike McCloskey, and I'm a resident of the Livingston District. As you may know, the Culpeper Planning Commission has recently recommended the denial of both of the utility-scale solar power plants that are currently under application for a special use permit in Culpeper County. The Culpeper North Solar Project is on 174 acres near Brandy Station, and the Open Roads Renewables Project is on 1,000 acres south of Stevensonburg. One article indicated that the Culpeper North Solar Project did not comply with the comprehensive plan and that it was the wrong place for this type of facility. They are concerned that these facilities will change the character of the county and have other negative impacts. In addition, the Culpeper Board of Supervisors recently voted to commission an independent study of the potential impacts on property values for neighbors of large solar power facilities. A request for proposals has been written, and a reference to the RFP has been provided in my written submission to you. Clearly, Culpeper County has many of the same concerns as we do as citizens of Spotsylvania County regarding these large solar power plants. I recommend that the Planning Commission suggest to the Spotsylvania Board of Supervisors either to commission their own real estate appraisal impact study or co-sponsor the Culpeper study. Obtaining an unbiased evaluation of likely impacts on neighboring property values will be an extremely important component of an overall cost-benefit analysis that should be done by Spotsylvania County. To discuss the real estate appraisal study RFP, please contact Culpeper Board of Supervisors member Jack Frazier, and his contact information is included in my written submission. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Kevin McCarthy, followed by Vivian Stanley.
Kevin McCarthy in the, from the Livingston District. Thanks for the opportunity to speak to you again tonight. 6 months ago, most of us in this room tonight and those who were here last night didn't know all that much about solar power plants. Today, we're a lot more educated. Here's what I've learned. The solar industry isn't a business, it's a charity. It's sustained and propped up only through massive, obnoxious taxpayer subsidies. An April University of Texas study lists the subsidies for coal, oil, gas, and nuclear energy as between 96 cents and $1.31 per megawatt hour. Solar subsidy, $61 per megawatt hour. Without the subsidies, solar goes the same path as wind. After decades of investment, the wind subsidies are drying up and running out, and now tens of thousands of turbines rot throughout the world. To illustrate this, I'll share a few quotes from various sources from around the world and from across the ideological spectrum. The Times of London: more than 300 million British pounds has been paid in compensation for wind turbines to lie idle in Scotland, sparking calls for an end to the green energy subsidy junket. From Real Clear Politics: it's long past time for our government, United States government, to stop wasting taxpayer money on doomed solar projects. Forbes magazine: Spain's electricity prices were below the average in 2009. Today, they're among the highest in Europe, a result of adding so much solar and wind, leading the government to cut the subsidies. From the Daily Caller: every state in New England is reconsidering solar subsidies. The region is running risks of rolling blackouts due to the continual closures of more reliable power plants. A Harvard University study finds that the statistics showing solar to be competitive are cherry-picked. The Chinese dumping of solar panels artificially lowers the industry costs, and that the eventual leveled price of solar, that is without subsidies, will make it by far the most expensive form of power generation. Quotes from two Harvard professors: we put up panels where the subsidies are, not where the sun is. And second, this is not sustainable. It's a bubble. I don't think there are any longer tenured professors at Harvard. So I just have two questions. First, why in the world would Spotsylvania want to sign up and buy into this? After the land grab and the gold rush is done, the speculators and the panners, they're going to be out of here, and we're going to be still stuck with the 6,000 acres of junk metal, broken glass, and toxic cadmium. Second, do we want, as a planning commission, as a board of supervisors, and as the voters and the parents in this county, to be the ones who will be remembered for letting 10 square miles of once beautiful Spotsylvania be taken over by a bunch of out-of-state investors here for the gold rush, leaving in their wake a toxic junkyard, and for rejecting and overlooking the concerns and interests of residents, only to do the bidding of state politicians, crony special interests in Richmond and Washington? They're all in it for the money. They'll take the money and run. We live here. So we should speak truth to power, stand up against the special interest, and send the prospectors packing. Thank you. For those reasons, I urge you to recommend denial of the S-Power permit. Thank you very much.
Vivian Stanley, followed by Michael O'Beer.
Good evening. I had something all prepared for you, but I did that yesterday for the Board of Supervisors, and I was only allowed to deliver one page. Very disappointing, because I had a lot to say. So I decided I would take a different route today, and you won't have to listen to the crap that I had yesterday. So, as I was contemplating what I should say to you, a commercial came on the television. You have probably seen it if you watch any TV at all. It was about someone who had cancer from smoking. One of the most dangerous chemicals found in cigarettes is cadmium. Big surprise. It's just like the 100,000 pounds of cadmium that will be in that solar monster. It'll be there, and it'll go into our air, into our soil, and into our water. The woman in the commercial, her name is Terry, had throat cancer. A surgical hole had been placed in her throat. She was bald. She had lost all of her teeth, and her face was deformed. This is the same cadmium that the solar supporters want to put into the Livingston community for us to breathe and drink. Some support this solar madness. Of course, it would not be in their community. It belongs in the desert, not in an established community. Supporters claim that Spotsy would make money from taxes on the solar monster. But at what price to the people of Livingston community who clearly do not want it there? Are we worthless? Have we no value? My question to you, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? I ask each of you to search your conscience, choose the health and well-being of an entire community, or accept a few dirty dollars from a company who is just after more dollars. In closing, remember, never impose anything on others that you would not want for yourself. And Terry, the woman in the commercial, thanks to cadmium, she died. I say no special use permit at all.
Michael O'Beer, 11201 Chancellor Meadows Lane, Locust Grove, Virginia. At the pictures you've seen tonight of the runoff, the mud, everything I've read and seen from solar panels, solar systems, it's the same answer on every time it's as a mistake. It's either the grass didn't take not enough time, trying to make the deadline to make the connections to start up. Weather came in too early. Temporary storm systems not big enough to hold water back. This is negligence on the contractors, the stormwater engineers, DEQ, the county erosion, and the special use permits being too lax. Everybody in this room has seen pictures of my kids kayaking in my backyard in a swale that never held water before. That's because of the runoff from the clear cut. Last week, it was up to my knees, but nobody's seen pictures of that because my family has finally come up to the realization that nobody in the DEQ, federal government, or the county gives a damn about my family's safety, welfare. They don't care. Nobody wants to answer any questions I have for it. I've lived here for all my life, and this is the worst I've ever seen it. We had a board member come out, got out of this truck, looked across the field, says, oh, this don't look that bad. You're going to get a buffer anyway. My wife told him, says, well, if it ain't that bad, you'd live here. Oh, no, thank you. Got in his truck and left. All right. Then, I'd want Spotsylvania to be known for what it was supposed to be known for, not negligence on building this massive solar field. There was a board member that wrote this thing and says, if your house isn't worth over $340,000, then you are a burden on the county. Been here for 63 years. The only burden I did was went to Spotsylvania County High School. And that is the only thing I use from Spotsylvania County. No emergency services whatsoever. So how am I a burden on this community? I believe that I should have the same consideration as any other resident taxpayer of Spotsylvania County. Thank you very much.
Is there anybody else that wishes to speak this evening?
Good evening. My name is Bill McGrath. I'm in the Livingston District also. I don't have any notes, but I just was listening to everybody here and assuming that the facts are the facts. $60 per megawatt hour times 500 megawatt facility, there, somebody's getting $30,000 an hour as a subsidy. That's a pretty good chunk of change. So from what I see, it doesn't seem like anybody in the county is going to benefit from this other than some property taxes. When I get my utility bill, there's a delivery charge and then there's a generation charge, right? So Dominion's going to get some of this money. S-Power is going to get some of this money. I'm not sure how it gets all divided up. But I started thinking when you were talking about the comprehensive plan and how do we want the county to grow, and it looks like most of the county is rural, and that means there's a lot of farms. Now, I understand if a farmer has a good year, he'll make about $300 an acre if he's lucky, the weather's good and everything. If he puts in a solar facility and rents it, part of his land, he'll make about $1,500 an acre. So as you look at the comprehensive plan and your strategy, you're talking strategy, why don't we think about how we can help the farmers, maybe make some smaller solar facilities on a portion of a farm that they can rent out to a solar facility, not, you know, it's 3,500 acres, but maybe 100 acres or something like that. The farmer has a guaranteed source of income. He's not under the pressure anymore to sell his farm and go out of business and go to a developer or whatever and preserve the character of the county. Just my two cents here, just based on what I've heard so far tonight. But it seems like we ought to be looking at what's in it for us as a county. And there's probably a solution. Sometimes it's an easy solution. Maybe there's a million reasons why what I'm suggesting won't work, but maybe parts of that idea are viable. So just for your consideration, thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Clifford Tuck, Livingston District. I just want to refer to one of the previous speakers made a comment about a cost-benefit study jointly with Culpeper. Sounded to me like a good idea. I keep seeing the S-Solar ads in the Freelance Star, and it talks about tax money enhancement. That's one of their bullet points in the ads. And I happen to know, and I'm sure Solar X must know, that estimate was done by the Commissioner of Revenue, and I think it's $600,000 the more that the county would have. But it was made on the assumption that there were no adverse effects. It's a partial analysis, not a general analysis. It's lousy economic study. So when the Commissioner of Revenue turned that over without any commentary about it being limited, without any an implicit assumption that there's no adverse effects, I would say that's a very unfair type presentation. And if you had a cost-benefit study with Culpeper County participation, you might see that there are some adverse real estate effects. And in fact, it's very likely and very possible that the $600,000 that they would collect from Solar X be offset by a loss of reduction of other real estate values that are nearby. In fact, it could even be negative, which would be very ironic if that happened. It could be negative, and it would be no benefit at all to the county, period. Thank you.
Anybody else wishes to speak that hasn't spoken already? I thank you very much for your participation this evening, and I took many notes here. Any other questions or comments this evening on our new business? At this point, I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting adjourned. Thank you very much.